Woolridge. Doesn't need much of an introduction. As you know, Nick has taught many of you. He is the past director of BMC. And this past October, Nick delved into doing daily Inktobers in 3D. So he's going to talk about his non-photorealistic rendering approach to creating these beautiful pieces of art. So.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. And yeah, this should probably be titled How to Cheat for Inktober. And I'd always admired Inktober and thought, wow, it would be great to participate. This year, I'm actually on research leave right now, so I actually had some time to actually devote to kind of doing this kind of thing. And I still, even with that, I still cheated. So, I mean, part of what I was trying to do was I'd been working for several years on how to make non-photorealistic rendering kind of approaches, or in 3D. Most 3D users and 3D engines are focused on photorealism and or something around photorealism. And there's a lot of space, I think, to explore that is not photorealistic and to look at other ways of depicting things. One of the main ways that I love to see things depicted personally is through lines. I love lines. I love linear art. I love linear depiction. Other kinds of depiction are great too, but this is something that is probably that goes back into my childhood when I was reading Tintin by Hergé, or Georges Remy. And I loved the depictive approach that he had in this kind of this very clear linear approach. And in fact, this is known as la ligne claire in Europe, which is the clear line approach, this kind of monoline, very careful drawing, very perspectively correct, very structurally sound. And I love that kind of stuff. And and it's a perfect matchup with 3D technologies if you can get something like that. And this has certainly been acknowledged. There are a lot of tune rendering systems. There's NPR is a big thing that can be painterly approaches, it can be tune-like approaches. A lot of the commercial approaches that have been found are often called tune because they're trying to look like cartoons. Some more stuff by Hergé. Hergé was very, so influential. This is another a Dutch illustrator named Joost Schwarte, who's very directly influenced. But there are lots of other illustrators like Mobius or Jean Giraud, who's a famous French comic artist, and who had that amazing draftsmanship with this kind of clear line approach. Here you see some more shading, and we'll talk a little bit about shading later. I've also always been interested not only in linear depiction like that, but also in linear approaches to creating shaded drawings. And you know, you've probably all seen the kind of huge number of artists who do this kind of thing, Gustave Doré, these amazing illustrations by Bernie Wrightson for a book about Dracula. The contemporary guy, a Canadian-French illustrator named Nico Delors, who does these beautiful scratchboard illustrations. He's a great Instagram follow. And one of my favorites, Aaron Horky. And if you've been in my office, you've seen a ton of these. You can tell that I have a bit of an Aaron Horky addiction. He's from Minnesota. So all of this kind of like very careful, kind of geometrically informed line, the lines that are kind of very close to following the form. And of course, there's much, I'm not showing any medical illustration here, but that's also a big tradition in the kind of pen and ink style, eyelashing style of much medical illustration, and Gerald Hodge and Max Bradle and that sort of thing. So if I want to translate this to 3D, I have to be able to create the lines, and then I have to be able to create the shading. So if we look at the lines, what's nice to have in a linear depiction? Well, you need contour lines outside an object. You need to be able to control their width. It'd be nice to be able to vary the width somehow, and especially over distance. It's nice to be able to have some control over which lines get rendered. And there are some tools that actually do this, like there are built-in tools in Cinema 4D. There's something called Sketch and Tune. But I've always found that a lot of those 3D approaches that are kind of built in aren't very good. Like, they don't make nice looking lines, and I admit I'm picky about these things, but they often, the lines don't taper in the ends, and they end abruptly, and they look kind of like crap. So some of them are okay. For a number of years in Cinema 4D, I've been using a quirk of its kind of really old, creaky, terrible scanline render, the standard renderer, and it has some weird qualities. And one of them is that there's this kind of shadowy hack that you can do. If you have an object and you have a camera and you put and a background, something behind the object, and you put a light right at the position of the camera, it will cast a shadow. But a quirk of the Cinema 4D's shading is the shadow's a little bit bigger than it should be. And what's cool about that is that if you look through the camera, you actually see the shadow actually around the object. And what's interesting now, when you think about it, is where will it be casting a shadow? Where will it, wherever there's a depth discontinuity, that's where it will cast a shadow. And that's kind of like where most you want most of the lines to be. And so using this hack, this kind of quirk of this of the rendering engine, you can get some kind of nice looking shadows. The other thing is that you're using, to be technical about this, I'm making all these files available for you guys to download so you can kind of play with these things if you want. But the weird thing is that you create a shadow casting light that doesn't actually illuminate the scene at all. So you can light the scene however you want. But the shadow casting light creates this super dense shadow. Like, this is something you can do in 3D that you can't do in the real world. You can't project shadows in the real world, you know? But you can in 3D. So you get something like this. So you get a controllable line. You get lines that taper as forms roll off. You can do various things to adjust the lines. This is just using a default model from the Cinema 4D content browser. But what's really happening, if I move the camera and I don't move the light, this is what's happening. See, there's a shadow behind it. And the only thing that makes the lines work is that the camera is exactly where the light is. That's another thing you can do in 3D that you can't do in the real world. You can't actually put a light inside the camera, you know, or at the focal point of the lens. So that's what's actually happening. But it makes pretty nice lines. And you can create kind of robust, oh, has that been doing that the whole time and I just didn't notice? sorry, did I miss anything important by doing that? Okay, yeah, actually it's been off the whole time. And I was just with this kind of hack, you can make scenes that look pretty, like the lines work, they're fairly stable, but they have a nice kind of quality. There's some issues around it, but it was far nicer than some of the built-in rendering kind of engines, definitely better than Sketch and Toon could do. And you can kind of create something that kind of works in that way. So that's how I started dealing with that. Then there's the other issue of sensitivity to detail. And so since this is actually a light that is doing this, there are all these kinds of tweakable things on the light that you can play with, and you can adjust the thickness and the detail sensitivity and all sorts of other stuff to kind of get different quality lines if you want. I mean, there's one thing, it goes by super fast here. I wonder if I can, oh, God damn it. Okay, if I can grab that and get to this spot right here, which, where is it? No, there. This is making the light cast so many shadows that each individual polygon is casting a shadow on itself. So this is kind of giving you a sense of like the level of weird control that you have. So I don't leave everyone in the world out, since not everyone uses Cinema 4D and not everyone uses the crappy old standard render in Cinema 4D, I started to look into doing this in Arnold as well. And so I use Arnold in Cinema 4D. We now teach Arnold in Maya in the program. And Arnold's a really great path tracing photorealistic renderer, but they've recently added kind of toon shading as well. And so with toon rendering there, you can actually generate lines. And a real problem with their implementation is that by default, you can't scale the lines over distance, which I can't do in the other technique either. The other technique doesn't do that. But then I saw a smart person post on a forum and say, well, Arnold is actually, it's, you know, essentially a little visual programming language, you know, building a node network that can actually do some of these things. You can actually build an Arnold network that takes the ray length from the camera for each pixel, inverts it with a reciprocal, maps that to the line width. And so you can actually do this. And it's like, this was painful to kind of figure out, but at the same time, once you had it, then you can actually scale lines over distance, which is kind of great. So that's cool. It's not even, why that's not built in is just a little checkbox, you know, I don't know, but you can do it, so maybe that's why. So that's lines. So I can make lines with those effects. But what about the shading inside those lines? If you want to do that, you can obviously just use the lines and not use anything else. But I wanted to kind of develop a set of kind of really robust kind of you know, using lines, dots, patterns, make it high contrast and feel crunchy and crisp and like it might actually be on paper. And I wanted you to be able to shade it based on the lighting in the scene and to have those lines or patterns both conform to the geometry and conform to the paper. So in other words, you could have something that just sticks on the paper or is actually conforming to the geometry. So this actually shows a little bit of both. There are some things here that are conforming to the geometry, but there are some things like this halftone pattern that are conforming to the paper. They are invariant and they swim across, you know, so that's nice to be able to do that too, because sometimes you want that. And some of you at this point may be thinking Into the Spider-Verse, and yes, and a lot of these kinds of techniques were what they were bringing to Into the Spider-Verse, the ability to have these kinds of invariant patterns that are kind of on the surface and be able to have kind of offsets and lines and all that kind of thing. So it's, in some ways, this is all kind of the moment. And so there's some great tutorials out on how to get some of those effects in Arnold, so. So with the engrave shader, the basic approach that I used for this in Cinema 4D was to get some sort of texture, pipe it through a gradient so that you could adjust the way the tones were mapped, and then pipe that into the lighting information in the scene. And Cinema 4D has a unique mode, you know, in most compositing applications have application modes, like you have in Photoshop for layers, you know, there's multiply, there's add, there's all that kind of thing. In Cinema 4D, they have one called lever, which I've never seen anywhere else, and it just allows you to modulate contrast with a grayscale image, and it always produces super high contrast images. And so if, for instance, it's not super obvious here, but if you look at the way this is the result that we're seeing here and then mapped onto the surface of an object, it essentially allows you to use some grayscale image and it gets mapped to a nice crisp black and white pattern. And so, and you can also do similar thing in Arnold. You don't have to look at this, download it. This is horrible to kind of look at. If we look at doing this in Arnold, you can do similar things in Arnold. And so these are just some examples of different kinds of approaches for creating those sorts of effects in Arnold. So this is engraved lines that are conform to the geometry and then engraved lines that conform to the paper. And in the end, I applied a bunch of these things, only using Cinema 4D standard renderer, not using the Arnold kind of things, to do Inktober. And I was just going to do one, and then I thought I'd do another, and I never thought I'd do the whole thing. And then it became a bit of an obsession, and I just started, and then I kind of did the whole thing. And then I even started making variants for each some of the days and that sort of thing. So the first few, since I started late, I had to go back and fill in the first few because I was a completist. This was skin, this was hair, and I started experimenting with making things look more hand-drawn, and sometimes that worked and sometimes that didn't. This one looks terrible. Oh my god. Anyway, this one was skull, I think. Sometimes I was using scanned geometry, sometimes I was building scenes. This is a free model from 3D scan store, and so I just used that. This is using the volume modeling tools in Cinema 4D to build kind of trabecular bone. This is an osteoclast, and I found this wonderful scanning image of an osteoclast, and you could see where it had eaten away the bone. It was kind of amazing. You could see this pit that it, and it was moving along, eating out this pit, and so I wanted to create that kind of effect. And then this was one of the first times where I started to get a kind of much more hand-drawn looking one that I actually kind of liked. And so this is just a variant that I created where the line is wiggly and it's using crosshatch. So you start to get some of that feeling that, that somebody was actually kind of sketched this in. This was for muscle, and really I just wanted to render an eye. And so I did the lateral rectus muscle and then had to add an eye. This is a brain. This is from my own. This is MRI data that I've segmented into a model. It's my own brain, so I can use it. This was a pyramidal neuron that came from iWire. This is just a scene that I built of a synapse, kind of imagining a zoom in on one of those dendritic spines. This was for one called Cells, and a cliche, I wanted to show fertilization. One of the things I really wanted to get was that beautiful kind of fluid-filled sac kind of thing that a lot of medical illustrators have done, where you have the kind of counter, the shading is counter to what you normally expect. It's dark towards the light, but with a bright highlight, and then it kind of, and it makes it look translucent. And then the effect of the nucleus in the cell is actually just a light projecting onto the surface of the cell. It's all fakey, totally. And then another little light making the caustics on the other side. So this is all fake, but it works. And adding the zona pellucida division. I was starting to get the kind of hand-drawn shader to look very much more hand-drawn at this point, and I was kind of pleased with that. Cell membrane, ear, you can go through these things quickly. My son's teeth. if you have to pay for braces for your child, they do 3D scans of their teeth now, and you can ask for them. And so I did. And so his teeth look much straighter than this now. And then something I modeled in ZBrush, and then and had lying around, and so I could use it. This was for face and neck, and alveoli, and this was heart again from a scanned segmented model. This one, I have to admit, I cheated even more because it's almost impossible to get the lines to be going in the right direction. So I had to render it about five times with the lines going in all different directions and then just composite it in Photoshop to kind of make the lines go in the right direction on the right part of the heart. And so you could never animate this, or you would have to spend a lot of time figuring out how to actually get it to, most of these things would animate pretty well. This, you'd have to do something else. I forget what this one was, blood or something. And then I started coloring them and saying, well, it'd be kind of neat to kind of add color and see what these things look like and make it even more pulpy. Kidney with color. Glomerulus. So glomerulus, the podocytes and the glomerulus are are super fun. This is really fun to model, so I spent a lot longer modeling this one than many of the others. Here you can kind of see a halftone thing where I'm doing this halftone screens at the right angle and everything, trying to make it look like, you know, close up on a comic book. Intestines. I'm leaving out some of the bad ones. Stomach, bacteriophage. I really love that effect in the background that you see in some older kind of pen and ink illustrators like Gibson and other people, where it's not a difference in tone that indicates something in the kind of uniform background, it's just a change in direction of the lines and that sort of thing. Apoptosis with some color. pelvis. This is using a kind of a Voronoi noise to kind of get a stipple pattern that looks kind of like a real stipple, and in color. Those are terrible colors. I don't know what I was thinking. More terrible colors coming. Woo! Okay. This was the 60s version of the hand. And then the final one, which is the whole body, which is that body that I'd modeled in ZBrush, but then kind of brought into Mixamo and turned into a kind of running figure, just take a nice running stance and doing that. And then because that was October 31st, the alternate there was was jack-o'-lantern. And that suddenly makes it look a lot sketchier now. That is like, ooh, what's going on there? So that was my adventure through Inktober. It became a bit of an obsession there for a while, coming up with something new every day. I really enjoyed it. I only became very tired of it right at the very end, where I was like, oh God, gotta get this thing out. And I hope you have found this in some way useful. If you want, there are sample files to download at this URL. I'm trying to build some Maya-based ones, but my Maya skills are so rusty that it's like struggling through molasses to kind of figure out how to get things going. I have one Maya file there that shows the scaling line thickness over distance, and I'm trying to make the trying to build the engraved shader in Maya as well. So I may add that over the coming days as after I consult with Mark and figure out how to actually do that. Okay, well that's how to keep your fingers clean during Inktober. But actually use ink, it's good. Yeah, okay, thank you. Any questions?
Do you sell those as plugins?
Oh, no, I mean, I'm giving them away. You can download them. Yeah, oh, thank you. Yes.
I was wondering when you mentioned the two different kinds of shading that you employed. One was like forming around the geometry.
Yeah.
The other was like just whatever the raster tone.
Yeah, yeah.
For the geometry one, was it based on like the flow of the polygons, or was it?
Yeah, that's a great question. Often, what I'm doing. You take a bunch of different approaches. Sometimes it's spherical projection, sometimes it's shrink wrap projection. Most of the time it's just flat projection, and because I want the lines to be kind of going in a generally kind of contoured way in a particular kind of approach. I know I kind of want them going in this direction. I'll just flat project them in that direction. And then sometimes that leads to weird looking areas, you know, and so sometimes I would just tweak it so that area was in shadow. It was all very, just trying to get it out for the day. So that is an issue. Like if I were doing this like in a production way, in a way that I wanted to be really robust, one way to make sure you don't have to worry about that is just to make it conform to the paper. So imagine that this is, you're looking at this world through kind of the raster grid or the paper grid with the kind of the lines or whatever going just horizontally or, you know, relative to the paper, then you don't have to worry about the mapping. If you do want it to conform to the mapping, more like the engraving that you would see on a stamp or a piece of currency, you know, that kind of carefully engraved line, then if I were really doing it in a production way, I would probably want to just carefully set up the UVs so that I could get the lines to go where I wanted them to. And so that would probably involve a lot of careful interaction with the UV editor to make sure that the polygons were going the way I wanted them to, and that sort of thing, with reference to the UV map. Either that or see if I could get away with just doing a flat projection in one direction. Yeah. Yes?
I was just curious if you could share maybe some of like your tips for like budgeting time, because I know like that was definitely a part of like, this whole thing, right? Because you know, it's like you have to find that piece of the day, right, to like bust out something every single day. And then also, did you set like a cap for how much time you were going to spend on the composition and the camera angle versus like the render and the final? Like, how did you like kind of budget your time?
Yeah, it was. It's funny. I couldn't have done it if I weren't on a research leave. You know, if I actually had my job, I wouldn't be, you know, normal job. I wouldn't be doing it, because sometimes I would just say, I'm going to bang this out in 45 minutes, and then 3 hours later it would be, you know, because I'd be tweaking everything to be just right. So it really was just kind of iterative back and forth. Often, like for instance with that glomerulus, getting one really good podocyte and then saying, I can just duplicate this podocyte to make it look like there are a bunch of podocytes here. Okay, you know, just coming up with, it was very improvisational, really, and coming up with a composition where I could just show the part of it that I wanted to. I was kind of mercenary in that way. I was just trying to get enough so that I wouldn't feel too embarrassed. Yeah. Is that it? Okay. Thank you so much.